Welcome to NTN Nightly. I am Janelle Norville. This edition's top stories. Public sector unions agree to deferring salary increases as government revenue continues to be impacted by the COVID-19 pandemic. The rebound of the local tourism sector continues with the reopening of the Canadian market and the celebrating those who built this nation. The membership of the St. Lucia Trade Union Federation, TUF, has entered into an agreement with the government of St. Lucia to defer the salary payment increases and other benefits due to the impacts of COVID-19 on the economy and government revenue. The agreement, signed by the various trade unions and public sector associations comprising the Trade Union Federation, was entered into on the 21st of July 2021. The TUF, represented by President Julian Monrose, and the government negotiating team, represented by Chairman Vern Gill, agreed that the payment of the 1% salary increase due to officers in grades 1 to 18 from April 2020 be further deferred to April 2022. It was also agreed that the associated retroactive payments be paid as a lump sum by December 2022. The parties also decided that the payment of the 2% salary increase due to grades 1 to 18 from April 2021 be deferred to March 2023 and the associated retroactive payments be paid as a lump sum by March 2023. The agreement provides for a 100% waiver of income tax on the retroactive payments. The agreement for the deferment of salary increases does not replace the collective bargaining agreements currently in place between the government of St. Lucia and the affiliates of the St. Lucia Trade Union Federation for the period 2019 to 2022. Rather, it seeks to detail the implementation of the provisions with respect to the agreed salary increases. St. Lucia's tourism sector has received a shot in the arm with the reopening of a major source market. We get details from Jerrine Georges of the St. Lucia Tourism Authority.
Commemorating the reopening of the Canadian market, the St. Lucia Tourism Authority, along with tourism stakeholders, were on hand at the Huronneau International Airport to welcome Air Canada Rouge Flight 1878 on Sunday, October 3rd. The return of Air Canada signals the reopening of St. Lucia's fourth largest international source market. Air Canada discontinued its winter service to St. Lucia in January 2021 during the third wave of the COVID-19 pandemic. The first flight to St. Lucia returns after 9 months following the Canadian government's cancellation of all flights to Mexico and the Caribbean in February 2021. To welcome Air Canada, a delegation led by Tourism Minister Honorable Dr. Ernest Hilaire comprised the chairman of the Board of Directors at the St. Lucia Tourism Authority, Thaddeus Antoine, the St. Lucia Air and Seaports Authority, and President of the St. Lucia Hospitality and Tourism Association, Paul Collymore. The flight landed at 2 p.m., bringing a combined total of 148 returning nationals and visitors to the island. A commemorative plaque was presented to Captain Christopher Clark and crew members who disembarked to greet the delegation.
Till the end of October, it's going to be one flight a week. Thereafter, it's going to be two flights a week. And from the middle of December, we're going to be having four flights per week. Certainly, we are delighted to have so many visitors that will be coming to our shores. That adds more business to the taxis, to the sites and attractions, to the hotels, to the restaurants, and all the other sectors in St. Lucia will surely benefit from having more visitors coming in. And of course, we all know that so many persons depend on the tourism sector for employment. And ahead of Christmas, we're certainly looking forward to flights full coming out of Canada.
Air Canada's return service to Toronto on Sunday, October 3rd, departed with 51 passengers and facilitated the exportation of 2,545 pounds of fresh produce to Canada. President of the St. Lucia Hospitality and Tourism Association, Paul Collymore, speaks of the benefits of another market to St. Lucia.
This opportunity with having another source market reopen provides that opportunity for them to have the flights to come back to St. Lucia. Also, we see this here as an opportunity for all of our services to reopen. We see our taxi service providers, our DMCs as well, and many of the agents operating here and at the airport, not to mention our accommodation sector as well. So really, on behalf of the sector, and certainly on my own behalf, We want to say welcome back to Air Canada, welcome back to the Canadian visitors, and this market is very important to our overall business here on the island as well. We hope that moving forward, that the demand will continue to increase and that we can see more increased demand coming into St. Lucia.
Air Canada's winter schedule will include 4 weekly flights as of Christmas. St. Lucia is also set to welcome back WestJet and Sunwing in the weeks ahead. In 2019, St. Lucia welcomed over 40,000 Canadian visitor arrivals to the island. Keeping the destination and the diverse Canadian market top of mind, the St. Lucia Tourism Authority will continue to drive its robust, targeted marketing and public relations campaigns in the market, creating more awareness of the destination and access routes. Jereen Georges, St. Lucia Tourism Authority.
The Ministries of Agriculture, Health and Education have signed a Memorandum of Understanding to improve St. Lucia's National School Feeding Program and school gardens.
The Ministry of Agriculture, Fisheries, Rural Development and Food Security has joined efforts with the Departments of Health and Education for the purpose of expressing their commitment to collaborate and integrate efforts to achieve the common aim of enhancing school gardens and the school feeding program in St. Lucia. The school feeding program aims to reduce hunger and improve food security in line with the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals for poverty and malnutrition. The Memorandum of Understanding forges greater international coordination of efforts for an improved and sustained national school feeding program. Permanent Secretary of the Department of Education, Michelle Charles, asserts that the school feeding program benefits not only students, but also parents, farmers, and entire communities.
We have noted the impact that insufficient or poor nutrition has had on our students. We are familiar too with scenarios where the absence of the school feeding program correlates closely with high absenteeism in schools. And we are all too cognizant of what can happen to our school-aged children who slip through the education cracks in part due to lack of food and fall prey to social ills. I say all of this to emphasize the point that the implementation of initiatives such as these have a far-reaching impact and augur well for our communities and society as a whole.
This Memorandum of Understanding is supported by the CARICOM FAO Mexico Initiative, Cooperation for Climate Change, Adaptation and Resilience in the Caribbean. National Project Coordinator of the Food and Agriculture Organization's School Feeding Program, Sherry-Ann Smith, explains that the framework of the initiative in light of COVID-19 supports participating countries in their efforts to protect livelihoods, ensure adequate access to healthy foods, and ensure sustainable management of natural resources.
The Sustainable School Feeding Program initiative is based on activities such as the involvement of the Educational Committee, the adaptation of adequate and healthy school meals, implementation of educational school gardens, improvement of school kitchens and storage areas, direct purchases of product from local farmers and school gardens, improvement of the national school feeding policy in St. Lucia, and assessment of the health assessment of students. Our understanding is that school feeding in St. Lucia, as elsewhere, have long been established and recognized as an important instrument in facilitating learning, especially for poor and vulnerable children. Healthy and well-nourished children learn better.
Representative from the Mexican Embassy based in St. Lucia, Carlos Ivan Gonzalez Osuna, underlines the Mexican government's commitment to aid in St. Lucia and deepening diplomatic ties.
It is for me an honor and a satisfaction to participate in this ceremony that marks the launch of the implementation of the project on resilient school feeding program, which is part of the Mexico CARICOM FAO initiative, Cooperation for Climate Change, Adaptation and Resilience in the Caribbean. Recently reoriented in order to mitigate the economic and social impacts generated by the COVID-19 disease, and which has a budget of more than $5.5 million US dollars, the entire initiative, which benefit 14 countries in the region, including the 6 Eastern Caribbean states.
The Memorandum of Understanding took place on Thursday, September 30th, 2021, at the Tissue Culture Conference Room in Union. From the Communications Unit of the Ministry of Agriculture, I am Anicia Antoine reporting.
Minister for Health, Wellness and Elderly Affairs, Honorable Moses Jabatiste, has urged the nation to pay homage and celebrate the contribution of senior citizens to the development of St. Lucia. The call comes as the ministry commemorated International Day of the Older Persons on the 1st of October.
It's a time for us to reflect on the contributions of elderly St. Lucians to our development. It is also a time for the new Ministry for Health, Wellness and Elderly Affairs to use the occasion as a springboard for a new kind of engagement with our older, resourceful people. We salute the contributions they have made to the development of our beloved homeland. It is because of their commitment to building strong families and communities around the island in their youth that we can be proud of the resilient people we have become. We cannot forget them in this era. Indeed, we are the generation that will actualize their vision of a St. Lucia which is consistently able to offer its citizens the very best in socio-economic opportunities.
The global celebration of older persons is being held under the theme Digital Equity for All Ages.
Some of the focus areas under the theme for 2021 are bringing awareness of the importance of digital inclusion of older persons, highlighting policies to leverage digital technologies for full achievement of the Sustainable Development Goals, addressing public and private interests in the areas of availability, connectivity, design, affordability, capacity building, infrastructure, and innovation. Exploring the role of policies and legal frameworks to ensure privacy and safety of older persons in the digital world, and highlighting the need for a legally binding instrument on the rights of older persons and an intersectional person-centered human rights approach for a society for all ages. The Ministry of Health, Wellness and Elderly Affairs sees the International Day for Older Persons as the start of our contribution to the Decade of Healthy Aging, which commenced this year, 2021, and will go until 2030. It gives us an opportunity to bring together our government, international agencies and development partners, academia, professionals, the private sector, and the media for 10 years of collaborative and innovative actions to decisively impact and improve the lives of older people, their family, and wider communities.
In keeping with changes in international oil prices and government's application of the modified market pass-through petroleum pricing mechanism, the retail price of LPG 20, 22 and 100-pound cylinders has changed. The retail price of gasoline, diesel and kerosene remains unchanged. The price changes take effect from Monday, October 4, 2021. Diesel and gasoline remain unchanged at $13.95 per gallon. Kerosene remains unchanged at $10.06 per gallon. The 20-pound LPG cylinder increased from $30.80 to $31.70. The 22-pound cylinder also increased from $33.88 to $34.87. And the 100-pound cylinder is now $220.32 from $211.31. The next adjustment to the retail price of fuel products will be on Monday, October 25, 2021. This is NTN Nightly. Primus Hutchinson is up next. Stay with us.
Ase l'année a, l'année 2019 et puis l'année 2020, gouvernement passé des lois pour régler cette pratique qui a concerné la santé publique. Première, changement loi contre les fumeurs. Deuxième loi ça là, c'était pour empêcher fumeurs en pièce place publique telle que Habawi, bar, restaurant, lance, abo transport public, abo taxi et puis en pièce place réservée pour moun bache et puis débache n'importe quel type transport. C'est obligation nous toutes pour connaître et puis respecter ces lois ça là. Pour assurer santé nous et puis protéger nou kot waka. Se la loi twape ou pab, ebe piès business ou pab aji kot de loi sa la. La loi ka ordonneye paye alame $7,000 pou moun ki ni aji personnellement epi $10,000 pou piès business. Se pou nou chanje ki, an tan maladi COVID-19 sa la, ki nou fime nou menm, ebe mete kon nou an situasyon kon nou se satam, se l'abitid ki dangere pou sante nou. Nous tous décidons pour faire une génération sala, une génération sans fumée.
This is a message from the Ministry of Health and Wellness, supported by Power on this station.
Welcome back. We join Primus Hutchinson for the NTN Nouvelle Okweol.
Merci autant, Janelle. Monsieur, Madame, Département qui est une responsabilité pour information à gouvernement celle-ci, ça c'est GIS. Ensemble avec la télévision nationale PIA NTN, qui a présenté une nouvelle à Creole, présenté au Primus Hutchinson. Le maître a fait une observation et célébration de mon héritage Creole, rassemblé en studio NTN pour annoncer ses grandes activités pour célébration Sala pour le mois d'octobre, comme des habitudes. Mais l'année Sala, attention, c'est à ce guérison. Les organisateurs qui ont pris en considération pèse maladie corona sur toute la terre. Alors, ils ont porté un message d'espoir pour tous les citoyens cette fois-ci, à baptême la culture kajiri, pour considérer et vivre, embrasser la vie traditionnelle et pour placer attention à ces diverses remèdes à tant longtemps que nous tous te connaissons cette vie. Exécutif directeur pour Fondation pour développement culture, ça c'est CDF, Madame Ramona Henry Wayne, parler d'activité pour changer toutes ces gros grecs que j'ai fait autant pour développer ma culture, théâtre, folklore, à l'histoire, c'est que si.
Et pour 27 années, il y aura fait un chai travail qui a monde connaît local, régional et puis à sur la terre, tout le monde connaît about travail. So l'année ça là, nous caille point tout ça nous a on our way. Nous avons en way Alfred Jacobs qui a juste passé, jour passé. Nous avons fait Honorable Charles Cadet qui a passé l'année passée. Nous avons fait Virginia Alexander qui a passé aussi. Nous avons fait Vincent Joseph Yutovic. Gaff Saint Thomas nous a fait, il a passé. So a chaque monde a passé. So parce qu'il y a passé, il a allé jouer ces gens qui étaient nous ka l'année ça porté toi vaio timo so toi vaio so mon ki pate way pou pate connait about toi vaio nous ka porté encore l'année ça so ou kay apprécier toi vaio la ou a fait ou kay commencer réfléchir à ce toi vaio la you have fait a contribution you have fait pour simply see
directeur exécutif pour le moment en place recherche folklore FRC monsieur Melcher Henry expliquer façon que célébration ça a penché à résultat des maladies corona selon monsieur Henry même si observance la moi héritage créole pas ça fait en même façon qu'avant c'est faux et faut continuer pour cimenter l'essence culture en l'esprit celle-ci
ça nous quand commencer puis ça va nous rappeler bonne santé. Nous avons regardé tout le monde oisier, nous avons discuté bénéfices tous ces différents oisiers en programme ça là. Programme ça là, mon cas c'est ouais sur télévision, mon cas c'est ouais sur YouTube, comme ça. Nous avons l'autre programme, nous avons créé Creole là tout partout, c'est pour encourager mon pour parler Creole là et puis parler manière de la tête, ok? L'autre bail là nous nous devons porter la reine Creole vie mais nous passons ni mon passant engagé avec mon manière yo te café avant so nous kay faire un documentary. Now I don't know how to say documentary in Creole. Now do you know how to say documentary in Creole?
Nous kay produire un programme
asou la vie c'est scène des quatre. Festin violon, c'est un lot côté nous gagné Julian Charlie Augustine, tout cette ici qui est intéressé en musique traditionnelle connaître Charlie, et puis Charlie qui parler et puis un jeune homme qui a fait violin, Yannick James. OK? Bah là c'est ça nous voulons, nous pas voulons trois décisions en mort. So nous voulons ça qui a ma pipi dedans pour passer ça y connaître by jeune gens. Ça qui plus jeune passer yo. Nous gagner en messe l'église. Et mes l'église ça a point court en souffrière. Nous n'y a livre, I say hymn book, chanté. Nous supposons available pour le public là gagner qui en créole.
Mais monsieur, madame, nous avons plus à ce activité pour observation My Heritage Creole à ce l'autre nouvelle. En parlant de ça, ministre des Affaires Culture, honorable Dr. Ernest Hiller, en adressant pour l'observation My Heritage Creole 2021, fait comprendre de manière qu'il est nécessaire pour embrasser le thème là pour l'année ça là, ça c'est culture. Car, je oui, comme nous continuons à débattre, et puis malade corona, pour s'apprécier, apprécier, primaire, toute affaire culture nous, expressement, ces divers remèdes traditionnels, nous sommes habitués qu'à servir. Le ministre a dit qu'il est même très excité pour toutes ces activités qui sont déjà en place, malgré mon passage comblé, comme nous sommes habitués à faire. Mais il souhaitait tout cette liste un bon mois héritage créole. Et Dr. Hiller aussi, vous remerciez tous ces divers organisateurs, mais principalement Chambre de commerce, pour qu'à participer aussi, pour qu'à supporter ces activités pour observance là, expressement à ces diverses compétitions qui ont pris en cours. Ministre Culture aussi remercié NTN et GIS pour tes produits présentation face au public pour cette liste et la reste de la terre, côté cette liste qui a habité pour Yosawe. Monsieur, madame, ça c'est côté. Nous avons trouvé une nouvelle là pour aujourd'hui. Je vous remercie autant pour regarder. Je vous remercie une invitation pour venir plus loin encore. Si tu conserves la vie, vous pouvez vous poser une autre nouvelle à quoi. La présent, ça c'est le mon vieux poseur, Janelle.
Merci, Bill Primus. We now take a look at the weather.
Sunrise Wednesday at 5:53 a.m. Winds will be blowing from the east near 21 miles per hour or 33 kilometers per hour with occasional gusts. The weather will be fair to partly cloudy and hazy with a few scattered showers. Tides for Castries Harbor were high at 3 p.m. and will be low at 8:50 p.m. Tides for Beaufort Bay were high at 4:07 p.m. and will be low at 10:17 p.m. Seas are locally rough with waves and northeasterly swells 6 to 8 feet or 1.8 to 2.4 meters. Small craft operators and sea bathers are advised to exercise caution due to brisk winds and locally rough seas. The Atlantic high pressure system will continue to generate moderate to brisk easterly winds and locally rough seas around the eastern Caribbean region during the next 24 hours. A tropical wave located over the central tropical Atlantic is moving westward near 15 miles per hour or 24 kilometers per hour.
That brings us to the end of NTN Nightly. Join us next time at 7 p.m. with a repeat at 7 a.m. You can also catch up with us anytime on the St. Lucia Government Facebook page or YouTube channel. I am Janelle Norville.